anointed in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, King Jesus. The theme says, a winner. And we will take our reading from two scriptures, Joshua 1, 6 to 8, and Ephesians 6, 10 to 12. You may read for us.
Be strong, confident, and of good courage, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only you be strong and very courageous, that you may do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, that you may observe and do according to all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall deal wisely and have good success. In conclusion, be strong in the Lord. Be empowered through your union with Him. Draw your strength from Him, that strength which His boundless might provides. Put on God's whole armor, the armor of a heavy armed soldier, which God supplies, that you may be able successfully to stand up against all the strategies and the deceits of the devil.
We thank God for the reading of His word. The theme says, a winner. For one to be declared a winner, one must have fought in a battle. No one can be awarded this title if he has never fought. When two opponents enter a boxing ring, each one in his own mind sees himself as a winner. Even when soldiers are in a battlefield, each army sees itself as the winner. Every Christian is in a battlefield. Each one of us, we are in a battlefield. No Christian will ever find himself in a playground throughout his Christian walk. No one. That should be known. No one amongst us will ever find himself in a playground throughout our entire Christian walk. Being in a battlefield means that there is no time to relax, not even a moment. We are always fighting, minute by minute, hour by hour. We are fighting and we must win. God has already declared that we are winners. That is the theme for today. As stated in Ephesians 6:12, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, authorities, powers of this dark world. But we thank God that even before we begin to fight, God, through His word in Joshua 1:6, encourages us to be strong and have courage, because we will inherit the land, which means we will win as Christians. There is no losing. When Israel finally got to
Canaan,
after 40 years of wandering around in the desert, one could have thought, finally, they are going to relax. Not so. It was the beginning of another chapter. A chapter of fighting to get what God has given them. And they were expected to fight and win. There was no prospect of going back to Egypt. When a person receives Christ, he has turned a new leaf. When each one of us accept Christ, we have turned a new leaf, and that leaf will be challenged. The leaf will be challenged. It is our duty to see to it that the new leaf which we have turned must stay clean, and we must win. At the end of our journey, we must be winners every day. A Christian who has turned a new leaf is expected to fight and win all the time. God will indeed give him what is due to him. But he will have to fight to get it, and he must win. Bear in mind that the author of the fight is not God. It is the evil one fighting against that which is due to the Christian. Fighting against that which God has given his child. Whatever we are given, it doesn't reach our hands same time. It is planted in the spirit. And while it is on its way, unfortunately, because the evil one is also in the spirit, he sees it. That is where the fight will begin. It is not that God has not given his child. It is just that the evil one will challenge it, so that the Christian must lose hope and give up. We are encouraged, Christians, not to give up. Fight until we win. God performed a miracle where the Israelites crossed the Jordan River into Canaan. He performed a miracle for them, which he also performed for us as Christians. He stopped the water flowing downstream so that his children can cross on dry land. And indeed, it happened. Those Israelites, they crossed on dry land. Same with us today. God has already performed a miracle. He washed us by the blood of Jesus. We are already on the other side. But the side where we are, it is the side which is being challenged at the moment. Do not give up, Christians. You will win. These are only challenges from the evil one. Our God has already told us we will inherit the land. And he cannot lie. He is not the son of man that he can change his mind nor lie. He is Almighty God, the creator of heaven and earth. He cannot lie. Believe him. You will win. Israel fought a number of wars in Canaan. Just like us, we are fighting war every day in our Canaan, which is Christianity. The first war, as soon as they crossed the Jordan, It was the war against Jericho. They faced that war. They faced Jericho with its intimidating wall. The Israelites fought and they won that battle. Next was I. But there was a problem there. Disobedient on the part of a child of God, the Israelites, caused them to be defeated in the first attempt. But the second attempt, they won. They won the battle. Next were a number of wars which we cannot talk about today, but they won. Though they were a grumbling nation, they fought. Some they were defeated, some they won. These Christians, this is an indication of the life a child of God will live. A life of fighting and winning. Fighting and winning every day of our lives. That is why at the beginning I said there is no time to relax. But be encouraged. We are winning. There is no doubt. We will win as long as we endure. Now the following is what a person who wants to win ought to have. Number one is determination. We will read from the book of Daniel 3:16-18.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, it is not necessary for us to answer you on this point. If our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image which you have set up."
Determination is what the child of God needs to win. A child of God must enter the war zone with a determination to fight and win. He must declare himself a winner even before he begin to fight. The three young men we read about, Shadrach,
Meshach,
and Abednego, were determined not to worship the image of gold the king had set up. Those three young men were determined. They stood their ground. Even when the furnace was heated, even when the furnace was heated extraordinary that day for them, so that they can be afraid and give up, they stood their ground and they said, "No, we are not going to worship your gods. Even if our God does not fight for us, king, know that we will not worship your gods, your evil gods." What is your furnace, child of God? What is your furnace? Each one of us has his or her own furnace. That furnace is a war, an ongoing war which we will face throughout our walk as Christians. What is your furnace? Is it lack? Is it sicknesses? What is it? No matter how that furnace is heated, hot as it is, answer it like these three young men. And say, I will not bow to darkness. I am a winner. Even when there is no food on the table, sicknesses is following one after the other. Declare and say, I will not bow to darkness. I will fight and I will win. Be determined. And indeed, you will win. Children of God, being sick or being in lack does not mean that a person is not a friend of God. A person can be in poverty, yet he is very close to God. A person can be sick, yet be very close to God. Think of what happened to Job. He got very sick, but that man was very close to God. Same with us. Sicknesses, poverty, does not mean anything. It is just material things which will pass when we go. Therefore, we will remain close to God as long as we do not get out and allow ourselves to be defeated. A person who is determined to win is not threatened by circumstances. Circumstances do not threaten a person who is determined to win. We learned just now, the three young men, they were not threatened by that furnace which was heated extraordinary that day. The second point, if a person wants to win, he must focus. For that, let us read Nehemiah 6:1-4. Nehemiah 6:1-4 says, when word came to Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem, the Arab, and the rest of our enemies, that I had rebuilt the wall, and not a gap was left in it, though up to that time I had not set the doors in the gates, Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message: come, let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono. But they were scheming to harm me, so I sent messages to them with this reply: I am carrying on a great project and cannot go down. Why should the work of God stop while I leave it and go down to you? Four times they sent the same message, and each time I gave them the same answer. A person who is determined to fight and win must focus on what he is doing. The evil one will send many things to distract him, but he must refuse to lose focus. He must refuse to be distracted at all cost. Nehemiah was called by Tobias and Sanballat with the aim of making him to lose focus on whatever he was doing for God, and he was rebuilding the wall, but he refused. Child of God, refuse when you are called to lose focus. At one point, a discouraging message was sent to him from the same two men. They said, even if a fox can climb the wall that you are building, that wall will crumble. What a discouragement. What a discouraging statement. How can a fox make a stone wall to crumble and fall? Those are the kinds of words which are sent to us as Christians. We will be told we have not made any progress. We are still where we were 5 years ago. And if a Christian make a mistake and believe that, he will lose focus. Discouraging words thrown at us from the evil one must have no meaning to us. They must have no meaning. They must be meaningless. Yes, they will be thrown. You cannot prevent them. But just don't let them have any meaning to you. Child of God, who is your Tobias? Who is your Sanballat? It is the evil one. Through the mouth of your fellow brother, your fellow sister, your fellow relatives. But they are not the ones. They are just being used as instrument. The one who is sitting at the switchboard, in control of every discouraging statement, is the evil one. Your fellow sister, brother and relative is just a mouthpiece. He is just a handset through which the evil one can speak. Therefore, do not hate them. Love them, but refuse the statement. In the name of Jesus. Children of God, we are not to lend our ears to them. They will plant discouragement. And we will not win anymore. Do not lend your ears to them. The next point. Point number three. A child of God must have perseverance. Perseverance is another tool which is very important. A person who cannot persevere can give up any time. But remember, the road to the throne is not an easy one. The road to the throne is not an easy road. To finally get what God has given us will require some form of perseverance on the part of a Christian. It can take a while, even years, until we finally receive what we have asked through prayer. But we must persevere. David, King David, was anointed king over Israel in chapter 16 of 1 Samuel, verse 13, by prophet Samuel. From that time, from the day David was anointed king, persecution was the order of the day. He was still a young man, a very young boy, who was called from the field, from tending the flock of his father, to be anointed king over Israel. From that time, persecution became the order of the day in David's life. When he finally sat on the throne, it was after he had fought many times. It was after he has persevered. Finally, he won. And he sat on the throne of Israel. But it did not happen overnight. It took years. Same with us. We are declared winners. But it can take years before we finally see what we have won. I mean that which we have asked from Almighty God through the name of Jesus. Joseph is another young man who was told in a dream that he will reign over his brothers. We can read that one. Genesis 37, 6 and 7.
And he said to them, "Listen now and hear. I pray you, this dream that I have dreamed. We brothers were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and behold, your sheaves stood round about my sheaf and bowed down."
Thank you, Jesus. Joseph was told in a dream that he will reign over his brothers. To get to that position, the young man went through a lot. We all know that he was thrown in a cistern by his own brothers. He was sold as a slave by his own brothers. He was wrongly accused by Potiphar's wife. And it ended up in jail. But it did not cancel what God showed him in the dream when he was still a young boy. He went through all this to finally sit reigning over Egypt, being second in charge under Pharaoh. He was an Israelite, but he reigned in a foreign land, Egypt. Anything is possible with God. The young man fought with determination, and he ended up winning. That kind of character must be found in a Christian, in us. Fighting wars, yes, they will come. We must not deceive ourselves that we will sit on the throne. The moment we ask today in prayer, the next day we are sitting on the throne saying hallelujah. Yes, we will say hallelujah even before we sit on the throne, to show the evil one that we believe what God has told us, either in a dream or through a word, a prophetic word, or through what we read in the Bible. Show the evil one by not complaining that you believe what you were told, even if it takes 10 years, even if you pass this world without receiving it. Don't give an opportunity to the devil to celebrate when he see complaining day after day. Instead of praising God, refuse at all cost, even when the pain is there. As I said in the beginning, even when there is no food on the table, no car, no beautiful house, refuse. Beautiful house, no beautiful house, I am still a child of God, and I am close to God. That has no meaning that I have nothing in this world. Therefore, perseverance is necessary. The next point is obedience. Amongst the suffering and the waiting, there must be obedience. Without obedience, there is no victory. We will lose. When Israel went to fight Jericho, we will read that not long in Joshua 6:17. When Israel went to fight Jericho,
they
were told the city and all in it are to be devoted to the Lord. Only Rahab will be spared. Let's read it.
And the city and all that is in it shall be devoted to the Lord for destruction. Only Rahab the harlot and all who are with her in her house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent.
That was a command from the Lord.
Joshua,
and you all Israelites, go and fight, but devote everything to the Lord and spare only Rahab. But one man disobeyed, Achan. He took some of the devoted things. It might look minor, but it is called disobedience. He saw some beautiful stuff and he thought to himself, if I can have this, it will be well with me. Little did he know that he is disobeying any little command. In fact, there is no legal command. Any command given to us through the word of God must be obeyed fully. We cannot choose this one and leave this one. It is all called disobedience. There is no little sin. There is no great sin. Everything is sin. What he did led to the defeat of Israel's army against Ai in the first attempt. Though in the second attempt, they won. Gideon, in Judges 7, was told to reduce the number of fighting men, contrary to what Achan did. This one obeyed. He went to the river as he was told and did exactly as he was told, and the men were sifted. He remained only with 300. He could have said to himself, but God, how am I going to win? Look at that army. It is huge. I am feeling intimidated by that army. But the man obeyed. He took only those 300, and the rest were sent home. But because he obeyed, God gave him victory over the Midianites. Even in our key scripture, Joshua 1:7. Joshua was told, be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Success goes hand in hand with obedience. Lack of obedience equals defeat. Obedience equals victory or winning. Disobedience equals defeat. Joshua obeyed God and he succeeded throughout the time he was leading Israel. The man obeyed God. He never disobeyed. It was only his followers that were disobeying at one point. Of course, as a leader, All you have to do is to tell those following after you, this is what the Lord wants. It is up to them to agree or not to agree. It is between them and their God. Unfortunately, sometimes the punishment of one disobedient soul can go to everyone, like the sin of Achan. The whole army was defeated just because of one man. But the duty of a leader is not to sit down and force the followers. All he must do is to show them what God wants, which is written in the scriptures. Even God himself, he doesn't force a human being. He is the creator, the owner of every human being. But he gave man a choice to choose between good and evil. But he will tell the person, this is evil, this is good. It is up to you. He does not force. It means leaders cannot force. Even when they see souls disobeying, they will just walk ahead and continue with the next message as if nothing has happened. They will just continue. Christians, it is up to us to obey and win. Obedience equals success. Obedience equals winning. We have already been declared winners. But we can make ourselves losers by choosing to disobey. Obedience is necessary. It is written in Joshua 24:31. Israel served the Lord throughout the entire lifetime of Joshua and of the elders who outlived him and who had experienced everything the Lord had done for Israel. Obedience to God's commandment is crucial for a Christian to fight and win. Without obedience, there is no victory. Even though we are all declared winners. Lastly, it is to put on the armor of God. We have read just two verses, but the next verses, which we are not going to read, they are in that key scripture. That is Ephesians 6. If you read throughout, you will find that there is an armor which is expected to be on us all the time. That is if we want to win. We must never at one point take off the armor, not even one. If we take off one, we might lose. What is that armor? I will summarize it. It is salvation, which is the headgear. Every one of us has got that headgear. Salvation. That is why we are here. It must always be on. Wherever we go, we must never say, I'm alone. Let me just for a moment put off this headgear. If that happens, defeat has crept in. Be sure that defeat is creeping in. We have opened a tiny door. In fact, that one is not tiny. If one takes off the headgear, because he is alone and nobody is seeing him, be sure defeat is on the doorstep. Salvation is our headgear. Righteousness is the breastplate. The breastplate called righteousness must be on everywhere a Christian walk. Righteousness must be before him, behind him, on the side. A Christian must be surrounded by righteousness wherever he goes. Truth, that is another armor. It must guard the waist. Without truth, we are just like the devil. There is no truth in him. No Christian can like to be next to the devil. But if there is no truth, it is just like being a friend of the devil, because we are sharing a common interest. There is no truth. Truth is found in the kingdom of light. Lack of truth or lies or whatever is on the other side. There is a wall here. From that side, it cannot cross to the other side. That which is on this side cannot cross to the other side. Truth must guard the waist of a child of God. Peace is the next one. Next armor. It must be seen on the feet of the Christian. Wherever he walks, he is preaching peace. Even if his fellow brother and sister offend him, he does not answer back. He allows the peace of Christ, which is before him, to rule, reign, and take control. Faith is a shield which must be there. When that child of God is dressed from top to bottom the feet, he must have faith. He cannot survive without faith. Because if God tells him through the word that, my child, this is what I'm going to give you, or even he tells him through a dream and say, my child, or through a prophetic word, for those who have the grace of prophecy, my child, this is what you will have. If you don't have faith, it will be stolen by darkness because of lack of faith. And the word of God should be the sword of the spirit. It must be read every day of our lives. And lastly, prayer must cover everything. It must be prayer day in and day out. Prayer every day of a child of God. There is a thought that has gone around describing what Christianity is, and there is no truth in it. That thought says Christianity is about driving a good car. It is about living in a beautiful house, living a luxurious kind of lifestyle above everyone. That is a lie. There is no truth in that. That is not Christianity. Yes, it is possible to can have that. And yes, it is good. It is possible to can have everything that one wants as a Christian. And yes, it is also good. It is beautiful before God that his child must enjoy while on this earth. But that statement, it is not true. One can lack and still be a Christian. There is an ongoing war. Because of this statement, it makes Christians to forget that when they are on the other side of the Jordan River, there will be an ongoing war which they must fight and win. That ongoing war is not forever. It will come to an end. That is if we persevere. People tend to look at healing, deliverance, and other benefits of being a Christian. Yes, there are rewards. But there is also an ongoing war against darkness. I said at the beginning, the author of that war is not God. The moment we ask from God, our God is a generous God. The moment we kneel and pray, or even standing, praying, through the name of Jesus, God will drop whatever we have asked. While it is moving on the way, as I said, God will plant in the spirit. While it is moving, that is where the devil will see it and cause this ongoing war. It is not that the war is from God. The war is from darkness, resisting what God has given to his child. For that person to get what God has given him, he will have to fight and win. And by the time he finally receives, he will have fought and had enough of fighting. Enough of fighting. But the good thing is, he will win. Were we not told at the beginning that we are winners? Yes, we were told we will win, but fighting, we will fight. We must not forget that. The truth is, we are all winners, each one of us. There is no loser here. We are all winners. A winner or a fighter means that he will always be walking, fighting. Sometimes the gunshot or the knife can stab him, a child of God, if by any chance he is stabbed. The wound must only be on the front. It must only be on his front. And it will heal. The child of God must never be found with a wound on his back. If a wound is found on his back, that child of God needs deliverance. It means he was running away. How can a child of God run? Is Jesus not there? If a wound come, let it come. I'll be going forward. And it will heal. No wound at the back. No, refuse it.